Hey, you've been mentioning a lot about wanting to do a movie night in your theater, and I think tonight's the perfect night for it. I even brought over a movie. I got it for my grandmother for Christmas. But we can watch it tonight.
Oh, Wolf of Wall Street.
Yeah, yeah. That movie has the F-bomb more than any other movie.
Hold on. Wasn't expecting anyone.
Hey, buddy. How you doing? Listen, sorry to bother you, but my car ran out of gas right in front of your house. There's a gas station about a mile and a half away. Could you give me a quick ride there?
Holy crap. It's the dude from...
Wait, are you?
What are the cool?
Are you the guy? Are you the wolf? Are you Jordan?
I am. Yes, I am.
Dude, you were in town.
We were just speaking about you.
There you go. Okay. Well,
yeah, sure.
Come on in, buddy. I appreciate it.
Come in. We're gladly.
Well, I'll go ahead and
load that up. Now we have to watch the movie.
Brilliant.
I do have one question. Zach, why are you skipping?
I'm excited.
When Zach's excited, he skips.
Okay.
Let's jump in the car. One of the questions I do, I've been, when I saw that movie, I was like, could this possibly happen to one man?
The parts that you probably are wondering if they're true, they are true. Some of the stuff's not, but most of the crazy stuff.
The boat
stuff,
capsizing, the plane crashing.
All true. Yep. And look at Lamborghini. All right, well, you know the scene with the Lamborghini, right? By the way, you should let me drive, because...
Wait a second, I remember that's the scene where you...
What's the chance of happening twice, right? There's no chance. I'm pre-disastered, right, buddy?
You're a good salesman.
I am, right? Believe me,
I might drive the first one, and
all
then
right,
from
fine,
next
okay.
time, once
there
we come...
There we go, I got an IOU.
Was that the true thing, right? It was true,
but listen, it wasn't a Lamborghini, it was a Mercedes. So
was it Quaaludes, or what was... What made him, like,
the Capra? Well, it was Quaaludes, but it was... The original real quails, like these ultra strong quails from 1978 that had a delayed fuse. Long story, but it was a good one, yeah?
Do you remember trying to drive the Lamborghini out of the Mercedes?
I remember it like it was yesterday, but I also could say that I could pass a lie detector test. I don't remember hitting one car.
The whole scene where for you,
no,
you just
remember.
Went home and then you were like,
I was like, thank God I made it home. I had no idea to this day I could pass a lie detector. I don't remember what happened. I really don't.
You know what? Before we jump in the. Well, we'll jump in the car, but afterwards, I want to ask you a couple questions. You can come on my little radio show.
Go ahead. Give me gas.
So in the movie, question for you. Did you help in terms of, were you on the set?
Just at the end, because, you know, listen, watching a movie and film is kind of boring, actually. It's very slow.
Right.
It's like, you know, it's watching paint dry. So, but at the end, I was there, and but I worked really, really closely with Leo on the script and on the, you know, really the dialogue.
Because you wrote the book.
Yeah. I wrote the book. Terry Winter, a great writer, wrote the script, and I went and kind of rewrote the actual boardroom scenes with all the stock stuff. But Terry was amazing. Great job he did.
So now you're where? You're here in L.A.?
Yeah, I'm back by the beach, South Bay, yeah.
Nice. You've been all over. I was reading, lived in Australia for a while. You lived, obviously you're from New York.
I just got invited to Iran today for 4 days.
Wow.
The speeches in Iran, yeah.
You gonna take that up?
Yeah, absolutely. Why not, right? I used to say that my movie was a hit everywhere but Iran and North Korea. Now I guess it's just North Korea. I was wrong.
Nice. So what, at this point in your life, is it all excitement? Is it travel, adventure? Are you back in business? I know you've got your sales.
A lot of consulting
and programs.
I'm fortunate that, my business has been great with speaking, consulting, and, you know, you get to a certain point. I mean, listen, the whole party craziness, like, that is a good memory.
Right.
But, you know, the things that make sense at 25 don't make as much sense at 55.
Right.
So I look back at those days, you know, and say, yeah, okay, I did it, you know. But now I'm married, I got a great woman in my life, so very happy, you know. But I'm always working on something, I always have a project I'm working on. I can't just sit still for more than a couple of days, I go nuts, right? This is good.
Yeah, this car is pretty fun. All right, that was a good drive. By the way, guess what is on the bookshelves here?
Ah, there you go.
This is a new one you wrote.
It is, yeah.
How many have you written?
Three.
So at one point, you make $22 million in 3 hours on this IPO of Steve Madden's shoes. And then you need to open up a Swiss bank account to put all the money in. So you put it in an aunt's name. But your aunt didn't know about it, right?
Well, she knew.
She knew.
She knew.
But then you go on this boat, and you get word that your aunt died?
No.
Is that, I got the timeline on?
No, that's the movie. I mean, that's
after. Oh, that's the movie. Okay.
Now, all of those things happened, but they didn't happen in that order. And the real
version. Did the yacht capsize?
Yes, the real version is much better. So in the movie, I'm on the yacht, and I get news that my aunt died, and I have to go back. They have to leave, right, and end up getting into the storm. That's not what happened. What happened was I had my yacht in Rome for vacation, and I wanted to go to Sardinia, and I was addicted to Quaaludes in a big way, right? Cocaine, you name it, right? Every drug under the sun, right? And I got into this frame of mind that you sometimes get into when you take ludes, where, short for Quaaludes, where I call the movement phase.
Yep.
Like there's the tingle phase when you first take a Quaalude, your fingertips tingle, you feel euphoria. Then there's the slur phase where you slur your words and you say, well, okay, I love you, slurring is fine, right? Then you get into the drool phase where you're drooling like, you know, but you're okay, drooling's good too.
Is this kind of the Lamborghini scene in the thing?
And then phase four is unconsciousness, right? However, there is a fifth phase, which happens once in a while, called the movement phase. That means you get like the drug-induced equivalent of ants in your pants. You can't sit still. It just so happened that as I was heading down the hill to Puerto Chevallarta, where the yacht was, I found myself in the movement phase, and there were white caps in the harbor, and when we got to the boat, the captain says, we can't make the crossing because there's a storm. And I said, I have to cross or I will die. Because I could not sit still. And I convinced the captain, unfortunately, using my powers of persuasion.
So this is where persuasion did you wrong, right?
Correct. And I convinced the captain to take the boat because I said, I said, Captain Mark, if we sit here, I will die in this. So he says, all right, we'll break some plates. I said, will we make it? He goes, we'll make it, but it's going to be really bad. I said, let's do it. It seemed like a great adventure, right? So I went up to the top deck, took four more ludes, fell asleep, woke up, and I was in 50-foot waves, and the rest is the same history.
50-foot waves.
Unbelievable. It was just a freak storm kicked up in the Adriatic, and we ended up getting rescued by the Italian Navy SEALs, which was amazing. And then what happened was they took us to Sardinia.
So not to interrupt you, but were the Quaaludes strong enough that you were sleeping part of the time when there was 50-foot waves?
No.
It woke you up? Because I've been in a big storm in the ocean. That'll wake me up.
I was an expert at something called balance. Like, I was treating my body like a human. I'm sober for 20-something years, right? But back in the day, I was like a Petri dish. I would take ludes to mellow out, cocaine to wake up. So I was balancing between ludes and coke that day. So I was awake for the whole, very proud of that.
Probably not the Buddhist meaning of balance.
No, right, exactly.
Not quite as much.
So I was balancing, right? And so I was awake and loving it because I wanted this. I was so happy that the boat was going to sink because it was so expensive and I was so sick. And I was like, this is great. And then like, oh shit, we might die. I'm like, oh, this is not so great.
Then you remembered you were on it.
Right.
You're like, wait a second.
Anyway, we got rescued, and then what happened was, 7 days later, we all had to buy everyone new clothes because all our clothes went down with the ship, right? The only thing we rescued was the Quaaludes, thank God, when the boat was going down.
They should have put that in the movie.
No, I sent my friend down for those. They were in the downstairs cabin. I said to my friend, you have the ludes? He goes, no, the downstairs. I said, Rob, you get the fucking ludes, you know? So Rob runs down. He comes back, goes, the cabin's flooded. I can't. Go and put a fucking snorkel on. Go down there, right?
Sacrifice your life.
Right.
I need my
they're in like a, they're in a hermetically sealed bed. Go get. He goes, all right, you're right. He goes down there, nothing. I go downstairs. He sees me standing at the top of the stairs with his pants down, his ankles pissing on the carpet. I'm like, Rob, what are you doing? He goes, I always wanted to do something like this. I'm like, Rob, just go get the ludes, right? He goes downstairs. He comes back up a minute later. I couldn't do it. I got shocked. The water's electrified.
Oh.
I looked at him. I said, soldier. I said, you fucking, I don't care how bad, unless it's like.
Did he get shocked while he was peeing?
Yeah, no, while he was down there.
Because it'll come right through
the
screen.
I said, you go down there. So he went, he goes, you're right. He goes, I'll do it. He goes, but if I die, get my wife a breast job. Just promise me. He said, all right, I'll do it.
Get Mark.
That's what he said? I want my wife to get a breast job. Pay for the breast job.
So not like the movie where you say, will you take care of my wife,
no,
Mr.
He just
best
wanted
friend?
The breast
will
job.
Will you get her a breast? Why did he want her to have a breast job?
She was bugging him for a breast job. He didn't want, he was cheap. So he said, if you pay for it, my death will be meaningful, okay? So he goes downstairs, comes back up with a bag of ludes and third degree burns and his hair up in his. Yeah, right? Right? And then 10 days later, here's the irony. So 10 days later,
we
go to the battleship first, right? And then we take some more ludes because it seemed like we should do that, right? And then we went to the Cal de Volpe Hotel, the world's most beautiful and expensive hotel where you take an olive. It's like they have a guy with a microscope, $10 on your bill, right? So checked out of there 10 days later, right? It's like $700,000 later, right?
700 grand was the hotel bill?
I had to put 18 people. It was nuts, right? So anyway, I bought everyone brand new clothes, right? Now this is the second time because my wife lost her bag. The story can go on and on. I want to get to
no,
the point.
No, keep going. Keep going. This is great.
Well, so what happens, my wife originally, when we were getting on the plane, the driver forgot to put bags on the plane. So I had to buy her new clothes. So before we got to the yacht, we stopped in Rome, went shopping, got her new clothes, and then those clothes went down with the boat.
So the clothes sank with the boat.
And then we had to get new clothes in Sardinia, right?
And then you went, it was the hotel, the $700,000 hotel, after that?
Yes, after that. So then we had to buy clothes, but it was only like Johnny Versace resort. It was like peacock. We were all purple and pink the whole week, right? So finally, the last day of the trip, right? I had this great idea. I said, you know what? If we bring all this shit back through customs, we're going to be hassled. My name was on a watch list already. I'm like, let's just ship it all back to DHL. All we need is a toothbrush and underwear because we're going on a private jet home. Great idea, right? So we all box up our shit. We send it off back to the United States. Next morning, we wake up, we go to the hotel, to the airport. No plane. I'm like, what the fuck? No plane. Now, this is back before cell phones, right?
Yeah.
You know, and no one spoke any English. And after about an hour, I was going crazy because I'm out of lewds now. No reason to be away from home anymore without the lewds, right? All of a sudden, some little Sardinian midget comes scampering up to me.
Literally a midget?
A midget comes up and goes,
didn't you guys throw midgets in the movie?
No, that's exaggerated. We talked about throwing midgets. They threw midgets after I left. I was not involved in that. So don't hold me responsible.
So anybody who's midget? This episode.
Yeah, exactly. Please don't. Hey, but the point is that he says, Mr. Belfort. My wife goes, plane crash. I'm like, what? My plane crashed 10 days after the yacht sank, okay? And like, it took off at Orly Airport in France. Seagull in the engine, gone.
A seagull hit your private jet.
So now I lost, so I lost the plane.
We got to say this. So for a second, your yacht sunk. Then your plane got hit by a seagull. Yeah.
So then pilots live, thank God.
Did you ever like wonder if there is something in the past life that happened?
So here's the thing. So right. I did make some great analyses that day. So after that happened, we got stuck again with no clothes in Italy, and I had to get out of Italy at this point. So we took a plane to London, a commercial plane. We ended up in the wrong airport, Gatwick.
But you had clothes on.
The clothes we wore.
Versace,
right?
They had like purple and everything.
But here's the irony, you know. How crazy drug addiction is. Is that at that time you'd think I'd say, okay, obviously God is telling me this. My life's out of control. There's something not right here.
Right.
Everything's insane. I'm doing drugs all the time. Things are happening. No. I went even crazy the next day. In other words,
use it as a sign you should be partying harder.
To keep going harder, right? It was a year later that I got sober finally.
Wow.
Yeah. So that's that's the true story about the yacht.
Now, the true story of Wolf of Wall Street. You heard it here. And by the way, I heard Chance the Rapper said today he wants to hang out with Drake because Drake has an exciting life. Chance, you probably wanted to be with Jordan Belfort in the Wolf of Wall Street
days.
You
should let me drive the car because who knows what could happen, right?
No, after I hear this story, I'm glad you did not drive the Lamborghini.
Right, but you have two, so there's only yet backups, okay? So I saw that. All right, so that's good. So anyway, here's the thing, though. I'm sober now for over 20 years, right?
That's awesome.
Yeah. And that was a miracle, by the way, and it was something that changed my life. But when you're in that headspace, you can rationalize anything.
Yeah.
Like you could just like, I said, oh, it's, you know, no, it's no problem. You know, I'm going to the bathroom, I'm shitting, it's green. You know, my nose is bleeding. I mean, it's a disaster.
Yeah.
But you're saying, oh, it's not, it's my allergies. It's my, like you could just, you know. So.
In addition to having this amazing life, you also are a master at sales. So people watching, I get a lot of entrepreneurs. Keep in mind that pretty much everything's about persuasion.
At the end of the day, I mean, you're always selling yourself. But I mean, I think that there's so many people out there that have great ideas, you know, great concepts in their mind, but if you don't know how to verbalize that or express it to someone else, it gets locked inside of you. You can't express that value, that greatness, and you end up dying with your music on your lips. It's a really frustrating thing to go through life that way. So
now this is something pretty rare. I rarely do interviews with a ton of notes, but I found your book and story so interesting that I was like, I'm gonna do extra detail. So.
You did homework, baby.
I did homework, but I read the book. I try to read a book a day, and this was my book of the day.
Okay.
So, you're a best-selling author, as people know. The book, the movie was adapted from your book.
Mm-hmm.
Leonardo DiCaprio plays you. It was nominated for an Academy Award for Best Picture. It's an amazing story. It also has the most uses of the F word in any movie, 569. Is that right?
It's either 509 or 560. Over 500 plus.
Was that because you are from New York and people in New York just swear a lot?
Combination of New York and Wall Street together is a deadly combination. It's like the most common word is the F-bomb, except for the word the. So it's, you know, neck and neck.
If you would have had a sailor story, that would have been, you could have combined Wall Street, New York, and sailors. So for those people, I think almost everybody's seen this movie, but you worked at first for this L.F. Rothschild, mm-hmm. working for a guy, Mark Hanna. And you got into the whole sex, drugs, and rock and roll world of Wall Street. Why'd you leave?
Well, you see, the movie is a bit inaccurate in that sense. That when I was at L.F. Rothschild, I was a trainee, right?
Okay.
And in the movie, it depicts me, you know, being this sort of bright-eyed, bushy-tailed, ethical guy saying, "Can't we make our clients money too?" The
right.
first day, and then the next scene, I'm in a strip club snorting coke. Right? That's not quite how
that
it
sounds
happened.
Like Zach.
Yeah, right.
Where are you, Zach?
You know, that de-evolution of the human spirit took about probably 2.5-3 years. So, at the time, I was, you know, a young, idealistic kid. I wanted to make a lot of money. I was married to my first wife. She was a great lady. But then, my first day as an actual stockbroker was October 19th, 1987.
Oh, wow.
Yep, the market crashed. Black Monday. And I watched in shock and awe as the market went down 509 points in a single day. And Rothschild...
Were people committing suicide back then? Any brokers jumping off?
If one or two jumped out, they probably would have jumped anyway. But the point is
that... They were just in a jumping mood.
It's always a jumper here and there around the world, right? But the point is that... Wall Street basically shut down for a time, and if you're probably a bit younger than me, I think you're definitely younger than me. It was perceived back then that this would be the beginning of the next Great Depression, that it wouldn't just stop there; it would cascade into the whole economy, and it didn't. So, but imagine back how scared and it was. Just
yeah.
The fear was incredible that day.
So baptism by fire, they
basically
call it.
Yeah.
So then you go and you ended up at this firm. It was Oak, what was it? Oak
well,
Stratton or Oakton
Stratton? No, I went to a firm called the Investor Center, which was a penny stock firm, right?
Okay.
And that was where I, it was really the first time I ever sold stock. And I became the top broker the first day. I just broke all the records.
Really? And the first day you broke all the records?
First day, yeah.
So you're do you think you're a born salesman?
Well, yeah, for sure I am. And there are people out there who are, you know, born closers, born salesmen, far and few between. There are some. When that really means, though, what does it mean to be a born salesman? What it means is that you're actually running a strategy automatically inside. You're doing it.
You're still following a script, but it comes natural.
Automatically. But you don't realize it, but you are following a certain protocol that gets you to the same outcome every time. So that's really what a born closer is.
So for those people watching that are entrepreneurs, want to learn sales, what did you do in that first day that you basically became a top salesman? Like, we're going to talk more about your whole sales straight line formula, but first day you didn't have time to implement a whole script. What do you do that most people don't do? Is it your tonality? That's one of the things, body language, tonality, taking people through features, not just features, but benefits. Like, what do you think you did that first day?
Well, in fact, one of the interesting things you said, like, you didn't have time to put together a script. In fact, I did.
Oh, you did?
Oh, yeah.
On day one.
I took 3 hours to write one. See, I would never, this is something, an interesting thing happened many years later, this is relevant, is that when I was tested by some psychologists about my ability to close, they put me through a whole battery of these weird tests, and one of them was a mock sale where I had to close someone in an investment type of situation that was being filmed.
Was it like, sell me this pen
Thing? It was, they handed me a some information on the dairy industry, and I had to then convince someone to open up an account at a firm to manage the money for the dairy industry, right?
Okay.
So they handed me about 10, 12 pages of information, right? And they said, take as much time as you want and, you know, to study this and let's see you close this guy, right? So I start reading it, right? I start writing down my thoughts. About 30 minutes later, they knock on the door. I'm like, yeah. I said, do you need more time? I said, yeah, just give me another 30 minutes. I said, okay, no problem. 30 minutes goes by. They come back. I said, just give me another 20 minutes. They said, no problem. Take 20 more minutes. I said, give me 15 more minutes, right? Anyway, after about 2 hours, I said, I'm ready. And I had wrote myself a really, really, not an exact script, but pretty close to a really killer script with sort of, you know, how I would actually engineer the sale from start to finish.
You were selling penny stocks.
No, this I'm talking now is recent, many years
later. Oh, recent, okay.
But I want to tell you this because it's relevant. Now, This is in 19. This is like I think 2010 that this happened, okay. Right? With psychologists being filmed.
Oh, okay. This is the
later. And
they
called in some guy who was an actor, and he was supposed to be the CEO of a dairy company, and I was supposed to close him. So we go through this whole thing. And I introduce myself, and we go through this back and forth, and they're filming the whole thing. And after about 15 minutes, the guy he's like, "Okay, fine, I'll open up an account," and he starts laughing his ass off. So I'm like, "What's so funny?" Psychologists come in, they say, "We told him under no circumstances should he say yes."
Yep.
Yet within 15 minutes he said yes. I don't get it. I said, "Well, you know, when I got the guy into a situation, did it make sense to say no?" He said, "Well, here's the weird thing. We've tested 100 other people in sales, and no one ever spent more than 5 minutes reading the material."
Huh.
You spent two
so hours. So preparation, it's some simple fundamental.
Strategical part of the straight line is about strategic preparation, meaning that my overriding concept is every sale's the same. Right?
Yes.
And that would seem to be counterintuitive.
Yes.
Because everyone has different needs, different belief systems, right? Different outcomes. You know? But the truth is that every sale is the same.
Yes.
And I'll explain that a little bit later on in the interview. But it starts with your ability to essentially make an airtight case to someone.
Yes.
On both a logical and an emotional level. Right?
Yeah.
About, you know, essentially why you're right to want them to do whatever you want them to do. Why does it make sense, right?
Yes.
And it's gotta be an airtight case, and then you have to be able to also accomplish other things as well. So there's two ways to go about that. One is to wing it, which you might be able to do if you're really, really great, or you can write it down, plan it out. I mean, the second one is where you really start to bring your averages up tremendously. So I'm a big believer in strategic preparation.
Yeah, so one of the things, I'm gonna skip around, sure. you brought this up. One of the things that you brought up, you bring up in the book, where did I put the book?
For those of you watching,
popping in live, this is his new book, Way of the Wolf. So you say basically there's the three tens. People need to be a 10 in three areas. On your product,
right.
On trusting you, and on trusting the company as a whole. And you talk about how most salespeople don't understand. You got to bring people to a 10 certainty that it's the best product for them, that it's the best company, and you're the best person to sell it.
Well, again, imagine a continuum of certainty, like a 1 on this side, a 10 on this side, right? And 10 means absolute certainty, the best products in sliced bread. A 1 means they think it's the biggest piece of crap ever, right?
Yeah.
So obviously you want your prospect to be at a 10 or as close to a 10 as possible when you ask for the order, right?
Yeah.
So most salesmen, even rookies, will intuitively know that. They'll say that makes sense, right? But what they don't realize, it's not enough.
Yeah.
You also have to get them trusting and connecting with you with
you
that same
person,
high level of certainty, right?
Yep.
As close to a 10 as possible, right? Versus a 1 being they think that you're a thief.
So sometimes they think it's a good product, but they don't like you, so they don't buy.
People don't buy who they don't like or trust or connect with, right? And the third element is the company that stands behind the product.
Yes.
So those three elements have to line up in every sale, no matter what you're selling. It doesn't matter. Tangible products.
You were selling dairy.
Information, ideas, content.
So if you were going to sell a pen, where's a pen? I meant to bring a fancy pen.
Sell me this phone.
Sell me. So the famous line in the movie at the end, they actually bring you in with DiCaprio, is like, "Sell me this pen." Now, I'm going to get to that later, what the interesting answer your business partner gave you when you did it. But the idea is, this pen, they have to think is a 10. They have to like you as a sales guy, and in this case, they need to think BIC, the company, is a great company. That's your ideal kind of framework.
Yeah. Basically, it is. But again, this particular exercise is really not about so much the three tens. It's really about what does a salesperson do when you say sell this, right? Well, the rookie salesman will say, "This is the greatest pen in the world." This pen, they'll start trying to do some version of the three tens, like,
"Yes,
this is the best pen in the world. It writes upside down, never runs out of ink. Best value, blah blah blah." So you know, talking a mile a minute, right? But the fact is that the only logical thing you could really say to someone before you sell them a pen is, first of all, are you in the market for a pen?
Yes, qualify.
What type of pens are you using the pen? You have to start asking questions, and this is the big mistake that salespeople make, because A, by gathering intelligence in the beginning, it allows you to identify their needs, their value systems, any pain they might be feeling about, you know, a lack of not having something, right? And just as important is that it's through asking questions and using certain tonalities, and you mentioned tonality and body language, and just as important, or even more important, how are you listening to the answers?
Yeah.
Do you listen like a robot without making a sound or moving a muscle? Or when someone answers you, do you say, "Aha, yup, yup, aha,
right.
Now that essentially active listening, this is how we really get into a tight rapport when it comes to sales.
Yeah.
So by asking these smart questions, and again, strategic preparation, you want to plan that out before, and I want to write down what are the questions I need to ask here, right?
Yep.
What's the best order to ask them in? Because there's certain rules for that, right? And what tonalities do I want to use when I ask those questions? I could say, so what's your biggest problem right now? And they'll be okay. Well, what's your biggest problem? And you'll hate me.
Right.
So there's a tonality.
Yeah, you talk about that later in the book. You talk about Bill, the charisma comes from a tonality that says, one, I care about you. Two, I understand you.
Rapport.
And three, I feel your pain.
Yeah, exactly.
You're talking about how Bill Clinton was great at that. People felt like, oh man, this guy gets me. Tell me what you think of this. I read a story about research on dating. So they put basically hidden cameras on people going on first time Tinder dates or whatever.
Scary proposition.
Scary proposition. But what they found was, as you would kind of expect, guys who ask dumb questions, don't pay attention to the answers, just kind of like, so how many kids do you want to have? Like that, they fail. And also guys who don't have the right rhythm,
right,
which you're calling rapport, sure. Like who either talk too much or don't talk at all.
Well, look at it this way. You know, there are certain commonalities to all human beings, right? When it comes to rapport, getting into rapport, both in a business setting and in a personal setting, but it really boils down to two things. Number one, that you care.
Yes.
That in business, you're not just there to make a sale to earn a commission. You actually care about the person and you want to get the outcome they're looking for. That's number one. And number two is that I'm just like you. And not like everything you like, I like. That's disingenuous bullshit, right?
Yeah.
Like, you know, you see a fish in the wall. Oh my God, you like the fish island. You start bullshitting about
that's like not, Michael Scott in The Office.
That's ridiculous, right?
Like
I'm talking about something very different. I'm talking about that you speak at the same general pace they do.
Yep.
That when they answer a question like, interest that you see, I get it, we're on the same page.
Yeah.
And it's almost below the surface, because here's the thing. Imagine, you know, you just meet a salesman, you're a prospect, right? And the salesman looks at you and says, you know, I really care about you. And you'll say, what the bullshit, you care? You want to make it, the word, see, in the beginning, there's no words you can say to say, I care about you. Over time, of course, you give great service, you have a relationship. Yes, you can tell someone I care, and I've proved that. But in an initial contact, that's so disingenuous. So how do you get that across? Through tonality and body language. That's how you do it.
Yep. So why do you think, what is it about us humans that for the most part, sadly, we only learn through massive pain?
Well, this is a truism for sure, because I think, you know, when it comes to values, right, value changing, I've done a lot of studying of that, you know, various types of psychology, NLP and stuff, and one of the things that they say is that, you know, there's either really one of two ways that someone really changes their values. One of them is through massive work and introspection through years of therapy, right? That's one way. The other way is with a painful event.
Yeah.
Something that happens to you and causes you to essentially reorder all the meanings that you've had from past experiences, how you apply meanings. And in that moment, you can make these dramatic shifts. That did happen to me. It happened to me when I went to jail and when I wrote my first book. You know, I had this moment where I was able to really, really sort of become the person I was before it all happened. Like the kid that my parents had sent out into the world, I was a good kid. I was a great student, never got in trouble. When I went down to Wall Street, I was idealistic.
Do you think it was the environment? You're idealistic, you get dropped in Wall Street, there's money flowing around, there's sex, drugs, rock and roll. It's just, because I do believe, one of my mentors, Joel Salatin, told me that the system trumps self-control.
The problem with that is that makes me a victim, but I don't believe in being a victim.
No, not a victim, because you could have left New York.
Well, here's the thing, so there's no doubt that the environment can be toxic to certain people, right? But to many people, it's not toxic. So obviously, I think with myself, at least, there were some things inside of me despite my parents being good parents and despite me not getting in trouble before, I had certain insecurities. We all enter adulthood with certain insecurities.
Right.
And, you know, sort of not feeling that we're as great as we, like other people might think we are. So here's what happens. When, you know, we see it in Hollywood a lot and in the music industry where you have these young stars, they go like when Britney Spears went bananas for a while, now she's normal again, great, yeah. Right? So, you know, what happens is that, you know, when you're growing up and you know, when you're in your early 20s and you don't have everything you want, you say, you know what, I don't have everything I want because I'm not successful yet. My life isn't the way I think it should be. So I understand that there is still pain and you can justify it. It makes sense. Yeah. But then what happens is when you all of a sudden become filthy rich and famous and successful, you still have all the pains and insecurities.
Yes. So it exaggerates what was deep.
You're like, oh my God, wait a second. I have the success, but I'm picturing it the way I want it, but I still don't feel good. And that's when the panic sets in.
Huh.
Because now you have
You got all that, but you didn't feel it?
Well, what happened was, is when I discovered the straight line system, right, which is really the topic of the interview, is when I cracked the code for teaching people how to close.
Yeah.
That was the game changer. I had stumbled upon a niche in the market, right, which was selling $5 stocks to the richest 1% of Americans. And no one had ever done it before, and that was a really lucrative niche. But what enabled me to build Stratton was I came up with a new way of training people how to close. And that system, the straight line, was so powerful and effective that within days of inventing it, it allowed me to take any human being, any old, young, regardless of their race, their age, their creed, their color, their socioeconomic background, their educational status, didn't matter where they came from, could have been Harvard or Hell's Kitchen. Yeah. I could take them in a couple of days.
Even if they weren't natural salesmen.
Absolutely not. That was
because you talk about it in the book. You took people in weeks and made them into
the
people
that world-class closers, yeah. Right? And the point, and to bring up that whole idea of a natural salesperson, what I essentially did was I was able to take the strategy that I was using automatically, slow it down, and put it into a step-by-step formula that could be essentially transplanted and inserted to anybody else with just a little bit of work. And to this very day, I still teach it around the world, and what it does for people, it changes people's lives because there are so many people out there that are brilliant, talented, hardworking, successful.
Good businesses they've launched.
But they just don't have that ability to get their point across. And what happens is, look at it this way. Every idea has a certain intrinsic value, right?
Mm-hmm.
But how someone else perceives that value is either multiplied or divided by the person who's explaining it.
Yeah.
So if I explain the idea, they're gonna think it's a great, if someone who's terrible at selling, they'll think it's a shitty idea. So imagine, I said this the minute, all the people out there who are these brilliant, hardworking, smart people, they wanna make money, they wanna provide for their families, they wanna help their parents, their communities, right? Great intentions, and they have great ideas, but they lack this one skill and they struggle.
Yeah.
And to me, it's the craziest thing, because here's the thing. It's learnable. It's a learnable thing.
But it's
thing.
Not, it's one of those things they should have taught us in high school, they should have, junior high. I always say, if it's important, they forgot to teach it to us.
One of the best clips on the internet, you should really play this.
Yeah.
Play it later on, right?
We can cut to this. Yeah. And we're going to put a link, by the way, tylopez.com/wolf. So if you go there, we're going to have links to more advanced stuff that Jordan does. And tylopez.com/wolf. And that will take you right to this. And of course, I recommend you can buy this book. I read it word for word, cover to cover on last night before you came.
Excellent.
Let's go into this for a second. So, in terms of, there's so much here. Let's check out all these notes. I want to get to the most important things first. We talked about,
we got the drugs out of the way, which is the most.
We got the entertaining stuff. We got the boat. We got the plane crash. I like this thing that you say, like human communication is 45% tone of voice, 45% body language, and only 10% words. Yeah. And what you said is, you know, people are kind of logical, but very emotional. The tone of voice and the way that you look in terms of body language, that's 90%. That appeals to the emotional side of the brain. And then you need to have good words that are logical. So what's a practical body? Because people love body language conversations.
Well, let me just back up for 1 second here. In terms of this idea of 45, 45, 10, right? That's been around for many years, many different studies about that. But here's the thing that you need to really understand. It's important. Is that I'm not saying that the words don't matter. They only matter 10%. In fact, the words matter 100% when you're speaking.
Yes.
But the thing is, you're communicating often without speaking.
Yes.
That's the point. So it's not like words don't really matter. The words matter. Because, yeah, you know, you say the wrong words, then you're perceived as an asshole, it's done, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So the idea that body language is so powerful, what happens is body language has a way of essentially slipping on through the radar of the conscious mind,
yes,
and going right to the unconscious mind and creating a gut reaction.
Yeah.
That, you know, something just must be there. It must be good. That person must be an expert. I want to speak to that person.
Or it might be bad.
Or the opposite.
Or I don't
correct.
Trust. You were talking about keeping your simple one, keeping too closed.
Right.
Hurts, yeah, well, sales.
Know, well, yes.
Or can hurt sales.
Or they could just be cold, right? So seriously, because you don't know. So the point is that...
No, but if you're the person doing the sales...
Well, I wouldn't be sitting here like this.
Yeah, you probably wouldn't be here. But people do that sometimes.
Yeah, that's a very aggressive... It's also an aggressive sort of angry pose to be as a salesman.
And resting bitch face. You hear that at RBF.
I know.
Where sometimes pretty women, you know... Not pretty women. I guess men maybe do it too.
It's RAF. Resting asshole face. That's what guys have.
Is that what it is?
Yeah, yeah. Resting asshole face.
So RAF and RABOOF?
Yeah, exactly.
And so where people sit there and like you see it at a club. I've seen it. And then you go up and talk to the person, terrible, and they're like, right.
Terrible affliction, resting bitch face for a girl. Because imagine a girl, right? And she's sitting there, and she's sweet as sugar. She, like, just has great things to tell you. She wants, and you look, and she goes, that girl must hate my gut. Look how angry.
Yeah.
It's a very terrible thing. So, by the way, here's the thing. That can be controlled, right?
Yes.
In all seriousness, you know, we make a joke about it, but whether it's resting asshole face or resting bitch face, guy or girl, there's so much more to it than just sort of how you are arrest. It is how you interact when you meet someone, the smile, your eye contact, how much eye contact you make, how close you stand to someone.
You
right?
said in Japan, you should stand closer. Well, you said 75%.
Yeah, exactly.
Wasn't that your rule? 75%.
Well, 70% eye contact.
Eye contact. Right.
Well,
yeah.
Because think about it. And by the way, you know, a lot of that stuff is not my material.
Just right. Seriously,
you
know, that's a general research.
The straight line is mine, but some of the stuff of body language, that was really well studied by psychologists where they actually did tests with people and they came up with these numbers and these things that are just sort of just truths, right? And one of them is that if you stare at someone nonstop, well, it's like a Mexican stare off. Like, what is wrong with this person, right? And you feel that you say to yourself, what's wrong with this person? Versus if someone doesn't make eye contact with you,
yes,
right? Now, I remember, I'll give you an example. My son, Carter, right? He had a friend going up this kid. I won't mention his name, Lucas. But the point is, no.
We won't mention Lucas's name.
But Lucas was a nice kid, right? But Lucas would never make eye contact. He'd come to me, he's like 10 years old. Hi, Mr. Will. I'm like, hi, Lucas. I'm like, what a trick. I'm like, he'd look away. And then we never. And I just didn't trust the kid, right?
Yeah.
Why? Just because of
no reason. He could have just been shy.
Nice kid. I'm sure he's pretty glad of it. But the point is, this ability to come off in a way that someone says, you know what? In sales, get to sales. What you really are trying to accomplish is that when the person makes that first instant perception about you, they should be thinking that, number one, you're a person worth listening to.
Yep.
And why? Because this person can help me achieve my goals.
Yes.
Now, if you want to get down to what are the three things that really go into that, well, here's what they are. Number one, you need to be perceived as being sharp,
yep,
sharp as a tack.
And then you said enthusiastic
as hell. Now, yeah. I'm not talking about enthusiasm itself, not that. I'm talking about bottled enthusiasm.
Right.
It's below the surface. It could be whispering, but it's a power in your voice, an excitement, and people just, it must be good, right? And the third element, which is the most important of all, is an expert in
right,
your field.
An expert, yeah.
Because
there's a chapter on the 4 seconds. Right, you got now, 4 seconds to
now,
convey
I,
that.
I said that in 1988. It turned out I was wrong.
Okay.
I was wrong. Harvard did a study in, I think, 2013 or 14, and it turned out it was 4 seconds. So I'm sorry.
So that was your guess.
That
four
was my, I guess four, it was five. And here's what else Harvard said. Here's the crazy part. If you make a bad first impression, it takes you 7 subsequent meetings to change someone's impression. Now, I don't know about you, but I never get 7 shots.
Yeah.
If you don't make a good first impression, you're done. So you gotta really focus on that.
So those first 4 or 5 seconds, you basically gotta come off as enthusiastic. You gotta come off as an expert.
Correct.
And you have, what was the first one?
Sharp as a tack.
Sharp, that's
now,
right, yeah.
Now, look at it this way. So how do you do that? Think about it. Well, is it the words that you say? I mean, the words don't exist.
Yes.
What would you say? Listen, listen, Ty, I'm sharp as a tack. I'm an expert. You say, what the fuck is wrong with you? You can't, the words don't exist for that, right? So how do you get it across? through your tonality and your body language. There were certain ways that experts sound, not the word, they sound, they dress a certain way, they carry themselves a certain way, and we know that as human beings because we've been conditioned since we were kids to recognize, because we were told, respect your elders, look, you know, when you went to the doctor, he was an expert, he had a stethoscope, he had diplomas on the wall, he wore a white. We've been conditioned to this. So what, now think about logic, what happens when you're in the presence of an expert? What do? You defer.
Yeah.
You let them control the flow of the conversation. They will ask you questions, and you will give them forthright answers. They've earned the right. So if you're perceived as an expert, it gives you the opportunity, it opens up the possibility for you to control the flow of the conversation.
Yeah.
And once you've done that, now you can go about making every sale the same because you're guiding the process. So the only way every sale can be the same is you're perceived as an expert, and then you use that perception as an expert, not to talk, but then you start to ask questions, smart questions, using the intelligence gathering tools, right? And then by doing that, you also ask them in a certain tone of voice, and with your active listening, that gets you into ultra-tight rapport.
Yes.
So by the time you're done asking your questions now, you know everything you need to know, you're in ultra-tight rapport, you know where their pain lies, their needs, right? Now, you can present your solution. So you have this, see what I'm saying is the steps, and it all starts to go into this sort of straight line. We do this first, this second, this third, and guess what? This is really easy to learn.
Yeah.
Once you break it down
You said 6 weeks it took you? 3 weeks?
No.
To take a beginner and teach them the straight line?
A couple of days.
3 days, okay.
I took these kids who couldn't close a fucking door, literally. Yeah. They were so bad. I mean, the average IQ was Forrest Gump on 3 hits of acid. This is not the short, deep end. It wasn't the deep end of the gene pool. Yeah. There weren't rich kids. There weren't kids who went to Ivy League schools. There wasn't an Ivy diploma among them. These were kids, the lower middle class, kids from New York and Long Island, they were kids that weren't told by their parents they were capable of greatness.
Yeah.
And any greatness they naturally had in them had been basically beaten out of them, conditioned out of them since they were born. First by their parents, then by their teachers, by their own friends, by their experiences from not feeling special, not acting special. By the time they entered my boredom at 19 years old, 20, they'd been conditioned to survive, not thrive.
Yep.
Once you're in that spot, what happens is that you have these beliefs that are supported by it. Well, you end up start off as this perfect individual day one. You're 20 years old, you're like already crammed down with all these limiting beliefs and stuff. So they came to my boardroom, and by teaching them the straight line, it reordered all their beliefs because I gave them a skill set that changed them who they were. It made them more effective.
Yeah.
So it can't just be I'm going to act effective. No, you have to actually be effective. So the beauty of the straight line system is that it's a skill set. It does change how you can communicate. It makes you a very powerful communicator and allows you to get the result that you want. So when you start getting the results you want, what happens? It starts to reinforce better.
Yeah, you become more confident.
Yes, and then that feeds on itself.
Where does confidence fit in? You talk about being sharp and enthusiastic and perceiving as an expert. Is confidence kind of part of, would you consider that part of the enthusiasm and the sharp
view? No, confidence is in probably everything. So confidence, there's two phases of confidence, right? It starts off with acting as if. No one starts off confident.
Yep.
I don't care who you are, okay? The first day when you trust, you're not gonna be confident, you're not gonna be an expert really, right? But you need to act as if. I would tell my guys, my kids back then, act as if you're a wealthy man, rich already, and you'll become rich.
Yep.
Act as if you have the answers and the answers will come to you. Act as if you have confidence and people will have confidence to you. I said, act as if. Now,
do you think people can become delusional that way?
Well, here's the point. Now, that can be, and you see it as delusion, when someone doesn't do the work to become the expert.
Right.
So that has to be coupled with the fact that I'm actually working and I'm on the hyper fast track to become an expert, to learn special skills, and then you're actually walking your talk.
Yeah.
And then it works. So you have to act as if until it becomes the truth, and then you're just acting as things really are. But you have to always act that way.
So basically, some people don't do the first part, which is get that initial catalyst, that initial boost to say, you know what, I'm not rich yet, but I'm gonna dress like I'm rich, I'm gonna talk like I'm rich, I'm gonna get up and work like I'm rich.
Let me ask you an honest question, right? You're an online, personality, right? You have a huge business, huge following. Let me ask you this. truthfully.
Yeah.
Let's say that I stripped every dollar you had.
Yep.
And changed your face. No one knew your name.
Yep.
And you had to start right now. Could you build it all back up again?
I think so.
Of course you could. You know why you could? Because you're still you. You have the skill sets,
right.
The talent. Okay. So there's, when you take away everything from somebody, they're still that same person.
Yes.
Now, if it's why when a rich person takes a tumble, they'll typically come back, right?
Yeah.
Unless they hit the lottery, right?
Yeah.
Or they were a member of the Lucky Sperm Club, right? Maybe they just inherited it from their parents, right? But for the people that worked their way up and made their money, they'll earn it back. When you have special skills, right? That is what, you know, and you have the vision for the future, you want to take action, right? That's what it takes. It's about special skills. People don't realize how much of success is not an accident. It's like, it's about people that have these extraordinary skills and they take action.
Yeah.
So I'm a big believer in learning skills. Like you wrote, read my first book, right?
Yes.
Well, when I first tried to write, I was a terrible writer. I taught myself to write by...
Wolf of Wall Street was your first book?
Yes. I never wrote before. I couldn't. When I first tried to write, I was a terrible writer.
How many copies have sold?
Millions of copies, right?
Wow.
So how did I write Wolf of Wall Street myself without a ghostwriter? I picked up a book called Bonfire of the Vanities and started reading it. Tom Wolfe, I'm sure you've read it, right?
Yeah.
And as soon as I started reading it, I'm like, oh my God, this guy's the best writer in the world. I want to write like that. And I used his book like a textbook. I took out my highlighter and I broke down his strategy for writing. And I practiced before I wrote the book. I said, let me first teach myself the skill to write like Tom Wolfe. And that's what I did. I spent about 6 or 7 months with 18 hours a day studying.
Really?
Oh, yeah, yes. To the point I could recite the whole book verbatim. Okay? Huh. Seriously. So the point is that I learned how to introduce characters.
It's almost like it was a mentor. The book was your mentor.
And my model.
Yeah.
And then I wrapped it up with Hunter S. Thompson because I figured it made sense because of the drug use, right? So I used those. And then when I was reviewing the New York Times, they said the book sounds like Hunter S. Thompson and Tom Wolfe. So it was amazing, right? That I accomplished my mission and turned myself into a writer. But here's my point.
So you basically reverse engineer. You see, I interviewed Kobe Bryant, did a little interview, and he said, you got to go to where great people who have created greatness before and reverse engineer it.
Look at this way. Look at it. I couldn't have done it without that skill.
Yeah.
If you want to go out there and succeed in the online world, you need to have certain knowledge and skills. One of them is going to be the power of persuasion and influence. It's a uniform skill in everything that you do. Whether you're a Bill Gates who convinced IBM to give you the rights to supply before you even own it and convince someone else to sell it, right?
Yes.
Whether you're a Steve Jobs, goes without saying, right? It's this ability to, could be just to sell your vision for the future.
Yeah.
To sell people, employees to come work for you, to sell venture capitalists on giving you money, to sell your friend's dad to a regular entrepreneur to get someone to invest in you. That's persuasion.
Yeah.
It's a linchpin skill to success. And that's why Warren Buffett said, if you want to succeed, you better learn how to persuade and communicate.
80% of billionaires is a good book. Did research on billionaires, and it basically said 80% of billionaires, before they got to their final company, they were learning sales first. They were sales. Ray A. Kroc started McDonald's. He was a traveling milkshake salesman.
Great movie. You see the movie?
Yeah, the new one. Michael Keaton.
It just goes, you know, and the commonalities there was A, great salesperson, vision for the future.
Yep.
And the ability to move through the setbacks. In other words, to not take no, to not get demoralized when things don't go your way. And here's one of the important things about that is that what creates that resilience, so to speak, in people is an entrepreneurial quality. You need that resilience, right? Well, a lot of it has to do with a fundamental belief that I myself am capable of achieving success. If I believe in myself, I become resilient. I know I can do it. What happens with most people is when they really get honest, their heart of hearts, they say, you know, I don't really think I got what it takes to be successful. I don't really feel like I'm that sort of person. I can't see myself being rich. And because of that.
Yeah, that is for sure the number. Well, the average person watching is like, I get it, but I don't think I can do it. What's your answer to them?
My answer is that, you know why? You know what? Study the straight line system, okay? Become an expert closer and watch how it changes. Because here's what happens. When all these kids that work with me, the reason they all became rich, filthy rich, right? Was because once you learn how to communicate, the power of persuasion, it changes who you are. It fundamentally reorders you. Say, you know what? I can move mountains. I'm not the guy who failed before. I'm not the girl who was you know, sort of wanted to play a backseat and not put myself out there. I feel comfortable putting myself in that hat. It changes everything.
Yeah.
And without the skill, what happens, people end up living a smaller life.
Yes.
And they don't ever get to that level where they're really firing at all cylinders and getting to enjoy the beauty of what life can be.
What percentage of potential do you think most people live up to? that aren't trained, that don't build skills, that go through the conventional school system, that have a job that they don't really like. Like what?
Probably 5-3%, 2% of people live up to their potential.
And those, or less. The other 95%, they're here. How much, if you were able to train them and they were to be able to get the right mentors, how high do you think this thing could go? 20x, 30x, 5x?
Now, remember this, how you define success is very different for every person. You know, Mother Teresa was probably one of the most successful people in the world and had no money. So yes. Let's talk about success in terms of money. This is a business segment, right? We're in business. So in that sense, assuming you have all your intellectual faculties, right? It would be impossible for someone who's really committed to becoming wealthy and was willing to do the work, to learn the skills, it's almost impossible not to succeed. How big is a question? How long it takes? Another question, because some of it's luck, meaning it might happen in 6 months or it might take 3 or 4 years. When I got out of jail, everyone would say to me, oh, you're gonna be rich again. And I was like, yes, that's true, but it might take me 5 years.
Yeah.
Because I'm not cutting any corners this time. I'm not gonna sacrifice my ethics. Yeah. I'm gonna do it right. I'm gonna do it every step by step.
How did that feel? You step out of jail, you had seen it all. You had had yachts, you had had, private jets. You didn't even care if your yacht, you had so much money, you didn't care if the yacht went down. How does it feel to, because a lot of us, a lot of people watching, you have to start over. So you walk out of jail. What's the feeling emotionally? Are you a little scared, completely confident? What's the state of mind?
I think that, the idea of fear, to say that I'm, when I met my wife, who's now the love of my life and the best thing that ever happened, seriously, she, changed my life in so many ways.
She's here today.
She's here also.
She's awesome.
And I'm not just saying that because she's here, it's the truth. And one of the things she said to me when she first met me, she was like, I can't believe you're like fearless. And I said, no, I'm scared shit. I'm just not letting it stop me. So there's a big difference. So I think smart people are scared.
So you had some fear.
Okay, everyone has fear.
Yeah.
Okay, that's what courage is all about, moving past. Without fear, there's no courage, okay? Yeah. In other words, of course I was scared. Of course I felt terrible.
What was your biggest fear?
My biggest fear is not being able to provide for my family. So my children family. And my wife. I love my children, my wife. I mean, in other words, I want to be able to provide for people I love. That's my big, to not provide for the people I love and not be able to take care of them is the worst thing that could ever happen to me.
Yeah.
In my life, okay? And everyone's different. See, that's my thing.
Yeah.
And knowing that is powerful. So once you know that, that is part of your why. And once you have your why, you can do a lot of
it. Yeah, I always say most people don't know what motivates them.
Yeah, that's my why.
So in your darkest time, coming out of the darkest time, you said, I'm afraid, but I'm more afraid of not taking care of my family.
My darkest time was when I was in jail, at night, in my bunk, alone with my thoughts, no money, broke, discredited, embarrassed, lost everything, right? And and people say, how'd you learn how to write, come out of jail? And I said, you know how I did it? When I closed my eyes at night, I'd see the faces of my two children. And I said, I have to make it right for them. I have to come back from this. And there was no way I would give up for them. For them. We'll always do more for someone we love unconditionally than we'll do for ourselves. And that's where you draw your power from and your self-motivation from the why. Why do I want to succeed? Why do I want to be rich? It's, why people will do insane things for religion. Because if you believe in something else, God be not yourself.
Yeah.
You only go so far for yourself, but you run through a wall of fire for your child and your loved one, right? Very big difference. So that was what propelled me. And also, the fact that, I got honest with myself. I knew, a lot of people go, they conspired against me, I'm innocent. I was fucking guilty.
Yeah.
I took a great thing. Forget the idea about selling $5 stocks. That was a great idea.
That wasn't illegal in and of itself.
No, it was totally legal. Yeah. I took the straight line system, which was the most powerful system for persuasion ever created. And it is, by far, nothing even compares to it, right? It really doesn't. And I took that system and I bastardized it. I taught it to people so they could go out and commit mayhem.
Yeah.
Now, there's nothing wrong with the system. It's how I applied the system. It's like an M16. Yeah. Is it good or bad? Depends who's holding it.
It was a pit bull. It was so powerful, right? But it turned the wrong way.
So I said to myself, I'm going to go out there and I'm going to prove to myself and my family, everyone I love, I'm going to do this the right way and I'm going to go out there. I didn't know how I would do it. I never thought in a million years Then I'd write a book, and the book would become a movie. I mean, who could think that? The chances of that happening are 1 in 10 billion. I mean, come on, it's like it never happens, right? You know, for every movie that gets made, there's 10,000 that don't. And for every book that gets published, there's a million that don't, right?
Yeah.
First-time author, so, but it happened. But when it happened, here's the most interesting thing of the whole story. So when I sold the book, it was a bidding war between Leo and Brad Pitt. I chose Leo because Leo's Leo, right? And he had Marty Scorsese attached as well. Terry Winter, the screenwriter, famous, amazing, yeah, brilliant screenwriter, he penned the script in 2007. And the first draft was brilliant. Usually, it takes them 4 or 5 drafts, right? His was right on the money. Scorsese read it, loved it. Warner Brothers loved it. They went down, struck a deal, 2007, right? Ready to go. I can't, my book's not even out yet. I'm like, they're going to make a movie. This is going to be great. I'm going to be rich again, right? The writer's strike hits.
Oh, wow.
They can't finish, right? Leo and Marty go on to do Shutter Island. The Wolf gets sidetracked. It takes 7 years for it to come back around now.
Huh.
And that day I was so upset. So what did I do? Did I cry? Did I? Well, no. What I did is I took that time, my wife and I, we met right around then, and we made a decision. It was right when the GFC hit, right? Things, yep, were terrible. You couldn't make any money writing. And I said, let's go into the speaking business, build a business together. And we started a business together. We built this big business around the world, speaking and mentoring, coaching, right? Around the straight line. And by the time the movie came back around, I was wealthy. And Leo's like, what the hell happened? You were broke? I said, well, he looked at the straight line. Marty saw it and said, oh my God, we gotta change the movie. The original movie ended with me in jail. They, huh, changed the third act to reflect what happened in my life. So I changed my own life story as it was happening,
wow,
through hard work, perseverance, and vision. And that's what I could say to anybody who's watching this. Doesn't matter where you are in life. If you're willing to put one foot in front of the other, but you gotta have the skills.
Yes.
It doesn't happen without the skills.
Yes.
Whether it was writing a book, whether it, anything you do, there's always gonna be a certain set of skills you need to be really high level at to get what you want, the outcome you want. One of them is always gonna be persuasion.
Yeah.
So study the straight line. It works, it teaches anything.
Yeah. So for all of you listening, watching, tylopez.com/wolf is gonna take you where you need to go to get the straight line system. Also, as we wrap up, I just want to remind you, Way of the Wolf, Jordan Belfort, is his third book. I read it. We need 8 hours to go through this. I'm actually going to put, we're going to record a little special module off air here on, for those of you who are in some of my programs too, because I want to talk on this objections thing real fast.
That's, by the way, one of the best aspects of the straight line.
Yes, how to overcome, because that's,
yeah,
you go to sell something and people are like, oh, I'll buy it later, or yeah, I don't have enough money, or, you know.
Well, meaning, let me think about it, let me call you back, bad time of year, it's Groundhog, yeah, Day, it's Christmas, fucking, you know, leap year, you know, right? It's always, you know, reason why. And the thing is that what trips up most salespeople is that they don't really understand what objections are.
Right.
You know, people say, this stalls, okay, fair enough, right? You know, the smoke screens, well, for what? What is it really, yeah, a stall? Here's the truth, what objections really are. Objections are smoke screens for uncertainty.
Yes.
When someone, remember those 310s?
Yep.
They must love the product.
Yep.
They must trust and connect with you, and they must trust and connect with the company. Well, guess what? When you ask for the order for the first time, let's say they don't really trust you.
Yep.
What do they say? Sorry, Ty, I don't trust you. That's very rude. They'll say,
right,
they'll say, hey, sounds good, Ty, let me think about it.
Yes.
See, they don't tell it would be nice, it would be a great world if your prospect said, listen, Ty, I don't trust you. I'm not,
yes,
I don't distrust you, I'm like in the middle with you. Your product seems good, but I'm like a 7 on the certainty scale, and the company, I'm at a 4. So make me more certain.
Right. People aren't even that logical. They're just going from the gut.
They don't realize it. It's all bubbling below the surface, and they want to be, so it's a circuit breaker,
yes,
to say, you know what?
It's a polite way.
Let me just say, let me end this call now, say, it sounds good, Ty, let me think about it.
Yeah.
Now the salesman, the novice will say, oh, I better be nice now, because this way I can get a call back and hopefully close them later on, when the fact is they're just not certain. So how do you handle objections? Well, first of all,
wait, I want you to hold this, because we're going to record a spec. We're going to stop the live camera. All of you who want to hear this, go to tylopez.com/wolf. We're going to have the links to get the straight line system, to get the video little. We're going to do a little module on objections, and it will have a link to Jordan Belfort's book. So this public interview, I know you got a lot of value.
But I want to give your guys, people, a special on the straight line system. I'll give them a big discount.
Yeah, we'll put a discount link on tylopez.com/wolf. But I'm going to tell you, this is one of my favorite interviews.
Me too.
This was good.